When Square Enix remade Final Fantasy VII, they honestly could have handed me a platter of warm garbage, and I would have eaten it right up and said, "Thank you, Square Enix, I'm your little baby, and I'll eat what you give me." But they didn't serve me garbage. Instead, FF7 Remake is a translation that's thoughtful and full of effort. It's like a love letter to this fictional world. And there's nowhere that's more evident than in the architectural redesign of Midgar, FF7's iconic and terrible city of energy. They didn't just polish up the polygons for this remake. They couldn't. Instead, the team had to redesign the whole city, and that's a big dang deal because we're spending 40 hours here versus the original game's 4. To understand why the design of remade Midgar is so brilliant, we need a refresher on how the city works in the first place. Midgar is split into sectors on 2 levels. Affluent neighborhoods sit on a set of plates above the slums below. The underclass is a literal underclass. In the center of the city is this massive skyscraper that belongs to the Shinra Company, home of beloved bad guys everywhere. Shinra runs the city, employing people, providing power, draining the planet of natural resources. And the fact that their building is the literal central support column of the whole thing, that's symbolism. Midgar is a special mix of cultures and technologies and architecture, and it comes to life in the remake. Everything we need to know about the city is channeled through the developer's use of materials and light and space. So, let's take a trip to the rotting pizza and dig into the juicy details of Midgar's incredible world design. The first urban area we see in FF7 Remake is Upper Sector 8. This is a business district with lively theaters, shops, and cafes. Of course, we arrive there right after our iconic main characters destroy Mach Reactor 1 and pelt the city with flaming debris. But other than that, this is a great place to live. Sector 8 is a perfect example of something we'll see throughout Midgar, a mix of icons from major cities. These design contradictions are purposeful, environmental director Takako Miyake said. They give the city a familiar but dreamlike texture. We might recognize the pieces, but they're combined in unexpected ways. So you get Art Nouveau kiosks and bus stops that recall Paris, while the bus signs themselves look exactly like New York City's. There are red UK telephone boxes sitting right next to USPS mailboxes, which makes me giggle. There is a main touchstone for this sector though, and it's New York City, baby! Square Enix shouts out NYC with a mix of 2 kinds of architecture, Beaux-Arts and these brick apartments. Beaux-Arts is very French, but in the 19th and early 20th centuries, architects all over the world, and especially New York, went nuts for it. Some of the most enduring American Beaux-Arts structures are built in New York City. One of them is a slender icon that sits on a triangular lot, much like this building in Sector 8, the Flatiron Building. Beaux-Arts has everything. Symmetry, columns, pediments, statues and statues and more statues, ornate stonework. It is so French. If Sector 8 were just Beaux-Arts, it would be easy to say, "Oh, so it is French, I guess." But you wouldn't, because that would be offensive to your ancestors. And also, it's not just Beaux-Arts, because Sector 8 is also full of these brick apartment buildings with iron fire escapes. Disastrous fires in the 18th and 19th centuries forced New York to revise its building codes to stop people from using wood because, well,
there's people that are dying.
But brick wasn't the only fire safety effort here. Landlords didn't want to take up valuable renting space by building fire-safe interior stairs. I mean, come on, who would? So they tacked on these now iconic, kind of useless, actually quite dangerous, fire escapes that you see all over the city. And they're all over Sector 8 as well. Despite the grim origins of this design, Sector 8 is a very nice place to live. The streets are wide and well lit. There are well-maintained public gathering spaces. There is
pizza.
And when I say well lit, I mean, boy, there is a truly silly amount of lighting here. The lights in the game are mainly bluish white, like here in Sector 8, or green, as we've just seen in Mako Reactor 1. And that's not just for mood. FF7 Remake's co-director Naoki Hamaguchi says they're meant to evoke LEDs and mercury vapor bulbs. Lamp heads out there will know that the use of LEDs and mercury vapor makes the lighting resemble Japan. Even though Japan is updating its lighting to LEDs, there are still enough mercury vapor bulbs out there that NASA photos in 2008 show the whole country tinted green. Here in Sector 8, where the tech is newer, everyone uses LEDs. But as we'll see in the more rundown areas later, not everyone has access to the latest lights. In Midgar, where there's light, there's Mako energy. Even in a fancy area like this, we see pipes and wires everywhere. The architectural design never lets us forget about the city's dependence on the planet's life stream for energy. Now that we've seen what quality of life looks like on top of the plate, we can really appreciate the slums below. Shinra is actively making life worse in Sector 7 by expanding the plate and blocking out even more sunlight. Sector 7 is a shantytown full of improvised housing. Shantytowns are built by residents for residents, and they are constant works in progress. Additions are made with scrap metal and anything else that someone could carry. Throughout Sector 7, we see buildings that have been improved with corrugated steel panels, and even some that are built on top of unfinished construction. Sector 7 looks like it was built because people needed a place to live right now. But in Sector 5, Aerith's hometown, we see a slum that's more established. The buildings here look like they've been used, built on top of, and then abandoned over and over again. Shantytowns share architectural DNA with their city centers. For example, in Portugal, houses are sometimes decorated with tile to keep buildings cool. You can see that tile in wealthy city centers and in shantytowns like Covramora. The same is true of Sector 7 and Sector 5. There are a few standout brick buildings here, and even a corner of fancy stonework that links the slums to Sector 8, but always with handmade additions from cheaper materials. This is a nod to Midgar's shared space that also highlights the lack of support given to the slums. The people here are doing the best they can with what they've got. Houses are generally small, so people congregate outside. Throughout Sector 7, people are gathering together to watch TV, drink, and chat under sparking lights. The lighting in Sector 7 is one of the things that most separates it from the upper sectors. In real cities, lighting is something that makes us feel happy and safe. That's why Sector 8 is full of light. But down here, where Shinra doesn't give a shit about people, there are huge swaths of darkness on the roads. By night, the whole sector is tinted green, which reminds us of that older mercury vapor tech. It also happens to look a lot like Mako energy. And up in the sky, on the underside of the plate, are huge lamps filling in for the moon and stars. One of the most thoughtful design choices here is that a lot of the lighting in Sector 7 comes from the residents. To combat the darkness, the people have put up fairy lights and neon signs, and they've even lit up broken car headlights. We have to enter the sector through this dark, trash-strewn industrial corridor, but when we get to the main drag, it feels lively and welcoming because of the light. Then there's Sector 6, the Wall Market. This is Midgar's down and dirty entertainment district. A feast of nightclubs and massage parlors and gladiatorial arenas and delicious-looking food that the game won't let me eat. Hamaguchi-san said that this area is based on Kabukicho in Shinjuku, Tokyo. Kabukicho has all the amenities of Wall Market, but without, as far as I know, an underground combat arena where I can get vored by Magic House. For the most part, these structures have the low profile of buildings created before Japan's economic bubble in the late 80s. When the economy got good, ever so briefly, high rises went up. But here the buildings emulate what we would have seen in the post-war era. In particular, this warren of shops and restaurants resembles a Kabukicho area called Golden Guy, which is a hotspot for cozy little bars. It's one of the rare Tokyo areas that retains these older style two-story buildings and narrow streets. A lot of Wall Market's buildings are also covered in media. Much like Kabukicho, it's a pedestrian-focused area where you walk around, see a sign for something, and think, oh heck yeah, I'll eat here, I'll go see that show. Oh cool, weapon. But like Sector 8, the Wall Market is a global melting pot. This white building here is an example of a false front. Western frontier towns used false fronts to make buildings look great from the street, which is exactly what we have here. A fancy white brick facade for a bank, where the back half is corrugated scrap metal, just like the other slum buildings. It's also the perfect visual metaphor for the Wall Market, which looks shiny, but hides a rotting core. To me, there's a sense of heightened fakery in the Wall Market. It reminds me of how there's an Eiffel Tower and a Venetian canal in Las Vegas. This is a place where people come to live outside of the real world for a bit. These buildings are all competing with each other for customers and attention. A couple of them really stand out to me. Madame M's massage parlor is an example of classic Japanese architecture. It's got this hip and gable roof called irimoya, which is a style that originated in China but came to Japan in the 6th century. Traditionally, buildings like this would be made of dark timber and plaster, but here it's painted concrete, a material that we know is readily available in the slums. Gang boss Don Corneo's headquarters is a massive Chinese-style castle that looms over the rest of the slum. It's a maximalist fantasy, with dragons and gold latticework and a decorative bridge. When I talked to Dr. Kit Brooks, they pointed out that this area uses space and architecture to intimidate us from the moment we start to approach the castle. We have to walk uphill towards this massive structure. And if what we're used to is this more casual slum environment, suddenly stepping into this is overwhelming. But this building is as much of a facade as the bank is. Corneo is a petty bully with an Italian name and a Chinese palace that lives on the edge of a perpetual construction zone. He's the king of nothing. But between the extravagance of Sector 8 and the shanty towns of the underworld, there's an unhappy medium. The Sector 7 upper residential zone is a topside neighborhood where Shinra employees live. This is a run-of-the-mill commuter suburb. A neighborhood of single-family houses, well-paved streets, and nice sidewalks. It's hyper-functional, inoffensive, and monotonous. Co-director Hamaguchi-san said that for this neighborhood, they looked at real-life residential areas with a lot of buildings crammed together. Its prefab profiles would be at home in suburban Japan, and they're just as recognizable to an American like me. It's Nowhereville. Upper Sector 7 has none of the structural insecurity that we see in the slums below. But crucially, it's totally lacking warmth. This is the only neighborhood we visit that isn't mixed use, and it's also the only one where we don't see people gathering. Everyone is cloistered inside their faceless homes. There's a bulletin board here that in a normal Japanese suburb would be used to notify people about local elections and trash pickup, things like that. On this one, we've got, a car ad and some Shinra propaganda. Yay! There is one very human detail here that I love, though. The sidewalks don't have curb cuts, so people have put down wedges in front of their driveways to smooth the transition from the street. This is one of the details that makes me lose my mind about the environmental design in this game. Like, you didn't have to go this hard. You made a whole asset so that I wouldn't question whether people were scraping their cars on the sidewalk? This is so cool. I love this. Okay, back to misery. These houses are all made of brick or stone or wood, and everyone's space is clearly delineated by walls or fences. Unlike in the slums, where property lines blur, these people are literally cut off from each other by architecture. It makes the neighborhood feel lonely. The Shinra building is, of course, the focal point of everything. It looms over the neighborhood like an octopus. Its pipes crisscross over the roofs. The roads radiate from it like the spokes of a wheel. These people work for Shinra, and there's essentially no barrier between them and the center of their world. We can follow these roads right to the Shinra factory, the heart of the company that's wrecking the planet and killing thousands of civilians by literally dropping cities on their heads. We've been running around it the entire game. As Hamaguchi-san wrote, "That building is so important to the climax of the game that we wanted it to always be there as a kind of cinematic foreshadowing. So we designed each area to ensure players always had an eyeline to it." The exterior of the Shinra building is totalitarian, Blade Runner-ass metal all the way up. Its interior is a revelation. It smacks you in the face with its opulence because there's nowhere else in Midgar that looks like this. The only thing that comes close is Corneo's palace, but even there, the decor is colorful and messy. It's the wealth of someone who covets and hoards it, not someone who simply has it and embodies it. The Shinra building employs a lot of floor-based lighting. According to lighting expert Hirayasu Shoji, this is a technique that department stores and fancy hotels will also use because it makes customers' jewelry sparkle. But here, it also represents the topsy-turvy state that Shinra has put the world in. We're used to lights coming from above, like Mr. Sun. But here, in the Shinra building, light, like power, comes from below. When I really think about it, most of FFVII Remake's gameplay takes place in tunnels and in factories. But those are not the parts of the game that I remember. I remember seeing Wall Market lit up at night, or running into Aerith outside the theater, or seeing these freaking curb wedges, what? I remember the places where people live, because the architectural design makes them feel cohesive and distinct and lived in. There was a lot of love put into this design, and because of that, I love it too. I cannot wait to see what the next game will look like. Please, God, let me see the next game. Give me a release date. I would love to see it. I would die for it. Please give me the next game. I want the next game. I would like the next game to have it now. I know there's another installment coming in June. That's not enough for me. It'll be great. I'll love it. I'll play it. I'll probably make another video about it. But I want the next game. I want a game, a full game, 40 more hours, 50 more hours of content. The next game coming to me on my PlayStation 5, playable, photo mode. Oh my God, please, yes. I would love to play the next